Praxis Prepper.
Hey everybody, this is Praxis, and I'm here again with Reed, who's going to help us through the question of how to set up a really functional solar system. In the first video in the series, we talked about how to set up kind of a grungy, it's like, you know, experimental, just kind of get your feet wet kind of system. The kind of system that, you know, is going to have some use, but is going to be kind of irritating, you know, you got to manage it and all that. I mean, people don't, ain't nobody got time for that, you know. The second video, we talked about these standalone units that a lot of people are buying, the pros and the cons of those. We mostly stuck to the cons because it's like, this is fear porn, pretty much. You come to Praxis for fear porn. And in this video, what I want to talk about is sort of like, you know, an ideal system, not an expensive system necessarily, but like kind of a, your first basic solar system that isn't going to feel like a science experiment. You know, you kind of get it up, it runs itself, it's a bit autonomous. Tell me that I'm not like going too far out on a limb here, but something that kind of like manages itself and you don't have to worry about too much. So I'll tell you a little bit about Reed first. Reed, hi, thank you for joining us.
Great to be here.
Reed is a really smart guy. He's an IT guy. He's the kind of guy that you go to at your company to, you know, fix a problem if you have some kind of a technology problem. Super sharp guy, and he's going to share some of that with us today. He has a lot of experience with solar. So let's go. You've got a pretty decent solar system that you've been building over time. What would you suggest to people would be a great way for them to kind of start into solar that doesn't feel, like I said, like a science experiment?
Well, don't copy exactly what I did. I bought a ton of solar panels on sale, and I've been slowly putting more and more in production. But the actual first step you need to get going is determining how much power do you need in your house. Very, very important first step. Now, that's often real complicated because people go, oh, well, you know, I need 100 amps feeding my house. That's my breaker. I need 100 amps. Something can produce 100 amps in solar power. Okay, you're going to spend a lot of money doing that. What you really need to do is sort of think about how can we alter your life a little bit. Say, do you have to really run the dishwasher, the microwave, the hairdryer, and everything else that uses a lot of power at the exact same time? Could we maybe alter that and say, okay, you know, I want to run the dishwasher at this time, and then I want to split it off and say I'm going to run this at this time. So if you can keep the maximum power draw a little lower, it would really help you. Now, once you know that, you need something to measure how much power do you need in a day. And if you need to think about it in conservation, because like when you get your utility bills in the mail, they'll say, oh, you use so many kilowatt hours, you know, this month. You divide that out by the number 30 or whatever, and you can end up with a number. And a lot of times that number can be, like for me when I first started, my number was around 30 kilowatt hours a day for average, you know, like in the spring and fall. In the dead of summer, where the air conditioners have to be used down here in the Southwest, we were close to 90 kilowatt hours a day, because that's a lot of power. And if you try to build a solar system right from the very get-go that can make that much power, you're going to think, oh my gosh, this is incredibly expensive. So you need to actually alter quite a few things. Like back when I originally first got out with solar, everyone had incandescent lights. So yes, I just dated how old I am. I'm not sure people even know what a non-LED light is anymore. But well, that was one of the things I did, was I got rid of all of my incandescent lights and I plugged in what was called a Conflac fluorescent light bulb, these little spirally looking things. And they saved a lot of money. They save a lot of money. I mean, today, people probably won't see that, but it was a huge savings to get rid of all your incandescent lights and go on to compact fluorescents or later LEDs as we have now.
I couldn't believe it. When I just moved into, I'm in this normal house now while I'm getting ready to build my homestead, almost every single light bulb in this place was incandescent. I didn't even think you could buy those anymore. I was shocked. I went through and just got rid of all of them, put in LEDs. I have the last electric bill from the people that had been here prior to me. They spent $200 and something for their electricity in that month, and that's including them having solar panels on the roof. The first month that I was here, just doing the kind of things you're talking about, you know, making more sensible choices, I used -$90 of electricity. So it was a savings of more than like $300 just by doing these pretty simple things. You know, it's like, you know, I got my television, my boy plays video games, and every, you know, it's not like I'm living in a cave, but yeah, exactly what you're saying. Just making a few minor changes can make big differences.
Yeah. Now, the other question we obviously have is, how do we measure the power? There's a thing you can see out there. There are these devices you plug into the wall, you plug your thing into it, and it says, this is how much power it's using. One of the most ones I see all the ones called a kilowatt. And I'm certain Praxis can put the link in the description for everyone if they want to see where to get that. And it does a great job. And you can sort of go, oh, this is how much power this thing's using. And so you can have it say, how many kilowatt hours does this thing use? You know, plug it into your fridge, let it run for a week, and then divide it by 7 to see how much daily electricity does this thing need to use. And then you go through and you get a pretty good idea of how much power we need to make. Now, if you start thinking about conservation, you can start trimming that out and then get a good idea and say, okay, this is what I have. I want to do this much power. And you may decide for the initial solar thing to say, okay, certain things I'm not going to put on the solar. Like a good example is a clothes dryer. Clothes dryers use, for an electric clothes dryer, they use a lot of electricity, a very high amount. So you can say, okay, I'm just going to have that stay on the grid. So we'll have a separate panel, electrical panel, to keep running the clothes dryer on grid. And for the most part, we'll just dry our clothes out on the line. But if it's raining and all that, we'll use the grid power. And so then you cut that out, that really high draw and some other stuff. So believe it or not, like I first started running my house entirely on 1200 watts of power for what I wanted to run. And that was the refrigerators, the lighting system and stuff like that. And I kept circuits for high draw applications on grid. But I first started doing this when things cost a lot of money. So today, you can go out and buy a 4,000 watt inverter, and it's like, I believe, $1,800 for a one made to run a house. That can run washing machines, dishwashers, hair dryers, microwave ovens. It can handle running a small window air conditioner unit. The key thing is it can't run everything at once. You can run your lighting and other stuff like that. But you're on that sort of budget, you're going to want to run one high draw appliance at a time. So you'd have like everything going on, your lights, you're watching TV and all that, and like go, okay, I'm going to run the dishwasher. And then you just got to wait until your dishwasher's done to run your microwave. So you just kind of plan your life a little differently. And so like that. Now, how do we pair up battery power, solar power, and the inverter size? So the question is, how much electricity we're going to use in a day? So say that in total, we're after 20 kilowatt hours in a day, and you're going to be a little under that. So that's like the high peak. Because unfortunately, if we go out of battery, there's no like a, you know, borrow credit card for battery energy. Once the battery's empty, it's empty. You're just out. So you'll want to pick your high watermark. So say like you aim for 20 kilowatt hours in a day. That we have to pair up with a bunch of panels to say we need this much. Now there's a great little website provided by the US government called PV Watts. Praxis can put that in the link as well. And what it will do is you can say, okay, I have this much solar power. And it will look at your location because you enter your address. It looks at the weather data and it says, your solar panels are going to make you this much power per month and per with the season. So you can see January makes this much energy, February is going to make this much energy, and we'll give you a really good estimate for your location how much a solar panel is going to make. Because unfortunately, when you go buy solar panels, you're looking at the pricing and stuff like that. It's like, ooh, 300 watts. So if you've got a 300 watt solar panel, you think, oh, so if that's out in the sun for 8 hours in the day, that's made me, you know, 2.4 kilowatt hours. No, it doesn't work that way, sadly. The weather, the clouds, how much sun we're getting greatly affects everything. So we have to take that into account. And this little nice application lets us do that. So you can say, okay, if I bought, you know, 5 kilowatts of solar power in solar power for panels, you can put that into this application. It'll tell you, okay, in your location, it's actually going to make this much power. Now, how do we pair that to battery? So if we're using 20 kilowatts of power in a day, what we need is the battery power big enough to take us through the night. So when there is no sun. So the idea behind that is you're going to need to measure what runs at night. You know, your refrigerator's running. Like, if you can keep some of the higher draw loads away from the dark hours, it can cut down the size of your battery. So you need to find out how much power you need for the night, because that's what you're storing for. So in the day, we've got to charge up and then store for the night. And so, like, I actually, when I was aiming to deal with about 18 kilowatt hours a day, my battery bank had a usable capacity of 10 kilowatt hours to take me through the night. And that was actually to run for about 3 nights when I budgeted my batteries out. Because I didn't need much at night. We need lighting and we need to keep the fridge running. I tried to keep all the high loads off of that.
That's exactly what I've done at my place too, that I've sort of divided things up and have some of the higher capacity things. I found that I was actually able to avoid using my clothes dryer for several years just by line drying. And here in New England, it's, you know, we have plenty of rain and it's always humid. That's why we have so many bugs around here and everything. So if I can do it, certainly anyone can do that. And by eliminating, like you said, those high draw things, or at least sort of, you know, spreading them out throughout the day, I found that that worked very well for me as well. I didn't really have the math behind it to you know, that I necessarily knew what I was doing. But in practice, I found out that that worked out really well for me as well.
When you buy a battery bank and you look at the battery data sheets, they say, we need at least this much minimum power to charge our batteries. So you got to make certain your solar power is bigger than that number. And then in the battery bank, there's also, we can only accept a maximum amount of charge. So there's a maximum of how much they can take in, and you can't go over that either. So your solar system has to be sized correctly. So once you know your power, you select your batteries, and then you say, okay, looking at the battery data sheet, it will tell me how much minimum power I need and what's the maximum it can give me. And then you size your charge controller to that, and then you can get your solar panels. So that's sort of how you go out. I like to build that way out, is find out my battery size needs based on my power usage requirements, and then I can size the charge controllers to that and then size my panels to those.
When someone's putting together this system, are there certain brands of, you know, equipment and you know, different devices that people should stay away from? Are there certain brands that you think are really reputable? What would be your recommendation on, you know, where people should, you know, begin in looking for, you know, what they're going to use for their different components?
Well, there are a lot of real cheap components all over the web. They're on eBay, they're on Amazon, they're everywhere. And they're just that, they're cheap. They're really badly made. I've seen lots of people buy inverters and they just stink. And they've unfortunately paid good money for something that did a horrible job. One of the things, like, you'll see is, like, they can't take a very good surge current and they turn off real easy, or for some reason they seem to be turning off when they shouldn't. I've seen that a lot of times. Now, I've actually been a subscriber to a magazine, not paid, not endorsed or anything like that. I've been a subscriber to a magazine for a very long time called Home Power. They're dedicated to solar energy. They've been doing it since the late 80s. And they do a lot of reviews on products, which is very helpful. Like, if you want to know about a ton of basics, what's changing in the industry and all that, Home Power generally has the answer to that. We can put a link for that in the description if anyone wants. But some of the really good brands of equipment, the one I stand by all the time is a brand called Morningstar. Again, not paid, it's just what I've used. I have stuff of theirs that's, at this point, almost 2 decades old and it still works. They are more pricey, often 20 to 30% more than I'd say for a lot of the other brands, but they tend to over-engineer things. If you go down to the third world in Africa or other places where things are set up at the micro scale, just getting some lights in some places, some of these villages, you'll run into a lot of Morningstar products. Because one of the nifty things about their products is they have no fans. They are completely passively cooled devices. And that's really neat. And the other thing about them that's really interesting is they rate theirs to provide full power up to 40 degrees Celsius, which is, I think, 105, 106 degrees Fahrenheit. And some of them rated for full power up to 60 degrees Celsius, which is really, really handy. Now, unfortunately, they don't have a very big inverter, like a 4,000 watt inverter. They're going to have one, they said, late this year. I keep pestering them. When are you going to get it? When are you going to get it? But at the moment, it's not out. So there's other brands out there. Schneider Electric makes a really nice one. Magnum Energy makes one. Unfortunately, the company was bought by another company, and so it seems like the quality control has slipped. I've heard repeating stories that, hey, I got a great one. Another one says, this one stinks. So that one you may have to double check on. Another one called Sunny Boy, they make various inverters that are about 4,000 watts or bigger. So there's some good ones out there. Now, a rule of thumb is you should be paying around 50 cents to a dollar per watt for inverter power. For a good inverter, that amount of rule. So like if you bought a 4,000 watt inverter, expect to pay around $2,000 up to $4,000 for it, and you probably got a good inverter. Now, one of the other things you will notice about inverters that are well-made, they're heavy. They're really heavy. What that is they have a transformer inside of them. And that transformer helps deal with the surges, because as a surge gets going, the transformer's magnetic field collapses and helps provide some of that additional surge power. Yes, I'm certain the electrical engineers are already ranting and raving at us for saying that, but that's the simple view of explaining it. But a lot of other inverters, like I've used one from a friend that bought one called a Renology one. That one was horrible. I hated that inverter. So
I actually had a Renogy inverter once. I've had two. The first one kind of fell apart. I got another one, and it seems like it was working okay, but I'd never had the amount of faith in it after the first one just spontaneously died. So yeah, they seem like they're maybe a little hit or miss. The prices are good, but hit or miss.
Yeah. Now, when you look at a lot of these inverters and all these pieces, there's a lot to wire up. I mean, there's a lot of wires going everywhere. And for a lot of people, that's going to be like, oh my gosh, this is a giant worst nightmare of where do I hook this? Where does this go? And stuff. And then you've got all these other little side sensors and all these things. It's like, oh my gosh, what do you do? Now, there's a company out there called Midnight Solar, and they offer pre-wired panels. What it is they will wire up the charge controller, the inverter, and everything on a metal panel. And so pretty much you're hooking up the battery and the solar panels to it. And so they've taken care of all the major ugly work in wiring that up. That company usually makes what's called interconnect equipment. So like boxes, breakers, and stuff like that. They offer these power panels for several different inverter brands. And they have ones for Magnums. They have ones for Schneider Electrics. They have ones for Sunny Boys. They have a nice selection there. And they're actually, if you go to their website, which we can put in the description as well, they have a really good selection to just poke through. And the inverters in there are of decent quality. There's only one I'm a little shaky about because it's more designed and made mainly in China, and that's Samolex. And I don't have any experience with that one at all. So maybe someone else will mess with it and say, oh, this one's great or it's bad. And we can hear something about that in the comments. But they have a good selection. And so you can get the whole panel pre-wired, and it really saves you on the wiring, saves you a great deal. The other thing that's nice about it, getting a pre-wired panel like that, is that when you go get these inspected by your electrical inspectors, they will see that, and they look at the way the wires are done in there, and they're nice and neat. And the inspectors will not usually try to beat you over the head with the Nazi stick.
I hope we haven't offended any Nazis there. I wouldn't want to offend the Nazi demographic.
Oh, yes. Please, let's not offend anyone. Now, you can do all of this yourself and take care of wiring everything else. Like here where I'm at, my jurisdiction, it's real easy. You just take a little test, and as long as you pass the percentage, I think it's 70+, you can do it as a homeowner, wire your own house. The downside to it is obviously you've got to pay for the permitting process and get it looked at. Now, the reason why you actually want a permit is because they usually, most places will actually do some simple checks. They're going to make certain you do have a proper ground, that your neutrals are not floating, and that things are pretty sane is what they're after. The other side is if you do have to sell your house, by having the permit in place and stuff like that, they can show that everything was done right and there's not going to be complications when it's time to sell your home. However, if you're in the middle of nowhere and you don't think you're ever going to move, it's like that. I've known plenty of people that have done everything totally on their own, not bothered with a permit, out in the boonies. So it's all up to you.
That's a really good way of explaining it. And I think that that conveys the fact that there's no one way of doing this. I think it's all unique to the individual, and there's lots of right ways of putting together a solar system. I did mine a lot like you said that you had done yours, where you had certain parts of your house on solar, certain parts of your house were not on solar. That's worked really well for me, since I started. I hope that this gives you guys a sense of how to put together a simple solar system. There's not just one right way of doing it. There's lots of appropriate approaches. And even if in your first crack, you don't necessarily pick the one best way for you, working with this stuff for a while, getting used to it is going to give you a familiarity that over time, you'll be able to customize your system and make it work for you. So thank you very much, Reed, for being with us today.
I hope everyone was able to learn something. And we haven't driven everyone nuts with a bunch of mindless technical topics. I hope everyone has a great day. And Praxis, it was great to be here.
If you'd like to learn more about the way that Reed builds his systems and how he's put a lot of his stuff together, you can go over to his YouTube channel. There's a link down below at Manifestation of Imagination. That's his channel. And you can learn a lot more, see a lot of his systems, and kind of get some behind the scenes look on kind of how we put his systems together from the ground up. So I hope you found this helpful. I hope you found it encouraging. It's a great aspect, I think, to a lot of people's lives. Just during regular times, forget like SHTF and all that kind of stuff. Just having used solar for the years that I have, I've saved a lot of energy. I've saved a lot of money using it. Sure, it costs a little money at the outset, but you save a lot. And the fact that you have some peace of mind that you know that, when the power goes out, you can kind of, at the very least, you can hobble through. I know that at this new house that I've moved into, it has really unreliable power here. The power has gone out a number of times, but knowing that I have my solar backup potential makes me not worry about whether I'm going to lose all the food in my refrigerator. It just gives me a great amount of peace of mind having this kind of stuff. So I hope you found that encouraging too, to try this out on your own. That's it. Thanks for watching. This episode has been brought to you in part by Prescott Caliber Club and Jesky Defense Strategies. Prescott Caliber Club is a federally licensed firearm manufacturer and retail store specializing in firearms, survival gear, and producing great online content. If you want to thank them for supporting this channel, go check them out at prescottcalclub.com. Please subscribe and tune in every Friday at 4:30 New York time for a new video. And if you'd like to support this channel, you can do so both through Patreon or PayPal.